So I welcome all the participants and our analysts for this session today, which is around the rewiring SME financing, what all the innovative financing solutions are available for SMEs at current present, over and above the conventional banking finance option that we always have. And I seriously hope that the deliberations at today's session will help the participant to address their financial challenges in running their businesses under these stressed COVID times. So before we start the discussion today, I request all the participants to kindly mute themselves for the entire duration of the discussion and switch off your webcam and videos. And please do not present your screen. This will create disruption to the speakers and the flow of the session. And today we have with us a highly seasoned panel of experts. We have Dr. H.P. Kumar, who is the former CMD NSIC and Director External Affairs, Power to SME. We have with us Mr. Jagadish, who is General Secretary, CASIA. We have Mr. Suresh Sagar, who is the Chairman, Banking Committee of CASIA. And we have Mr. Bhugal T. He is Associate Vice President from Tele Solutions. And before I hand over the session to Dr. Kumar, I will take a little more of your time to introduce the organizer, Power to SME. And so let me again share my screen. I think someone. Dr. Kumar, can you share my see my screen now?
Yes, now I can see.
Okay. So, sir, were you saying something?
Yes, now it has changed. It has come coordinate over.
Okay. So, Power to SME, it was established in year 2012. We are in ninth year running, and it was founded by founder and CEO, Mr. R. Narayan. The Power to SME was established as a demand aggregation platform completely in digital ecosystem. And it is a very innovative business model with which eliminates intermediaries in raw material sourcing to the manufacturing SMEs specifically. This is entire Power to SME ecosystem. We have four broad verticals. Power2SME.com, our portal, which is into raw material procurement solutions, which supplies raw material to the SME manufacturing SMEs. Our portal FinanceMe, it facilitates loan. It connects SMEs with the partner financial institutions for faster and seamless loan processing for their working capital needs. Our portal SME Shops, it is the India's biggest B2B e-marketplace, which deals exclusively in MRO and industrial goods. And our NBFC, it provides very innovative credit solutions for raw material procurement. So this is the entire Power to SME ecosystem. These are the key product categories that Power to SME primarily deals in: steel, polymer, paints, yarn, chemical additives, and there are several others beyond this. The major industrial verticals that we cater to includes auto components, includes agricultural tool, engineering, textile, and many more. You can see here on the slide. Recognizing the market demand during the COVID crisis, our portal SME Shops, it came up with the entire range of COVID-19 essential products. So both the SMEs and corporate can buy, sell, and procure these COVID products in bulk quantities through SME Shops.
Your presentation is not visible, only voice is visible.
Oh, let me.
It has stopped just for the last 10 seconds. Yes, now it is okay.
Okay, sir. We are the funded company. Some of the most reputed venture funds in the country have invested in us: Inventus, Kalari, Excel. Nandan Nilekani is one of our strategic investors. We are also World Bank funded company through its financial arm, International Finance Corporation. These are the few of the awards and accolades that we have won since our inception. And the worth mentioning is here Forbes India Leadership Award that we won under Outstanding Startup category. This is indeed the very prestigious award that we have received. This is our social media presence, and you can get in touch with us through any of these mediums. And this is it about the brief introduction of Power to SME. And I request all the participants, encourage all of you to kindly submit your feedback form, which is being circulated in the chat box by my colleagues. And also, if you have any queries to be raised to any of the speakers based on the discussion that is going to happen, you can also submit your queries to on the chat boxes itself. All these questions will be taken to the panelists at the end of the session. So with these words, I request Dr. Kumar to kindly take the session forward and begin with the discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Sumer. Thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Thank you very much. In fact, it's a very interesting subject that we are going to discuss today. Very good afternoon to all the participants, and let me acknowledge the presence of our distinguished panelists, expert speakers. We have very experienced, in fact, Mr. N.R. Jagadish, who is the General Secretary of CASIA, a very, very reputed organization in the country. Mr. Suresh Sagar, who is the Chairman of the Banking Committee of CASIA, and Mr. Pugal T., Associate Vice President of Tally Solutions. So we will have detailed deliberations with all these experts, in fact, during the course of our discussions in time to come. Let me, first of all, you know, introduce the subject, Rewiring SME Financing. Very catchy, of course. And what are the innovative solutions to new age SMEs? Now, you see, I have been a banker myself. And when I started my banking career, let me tell you, we had very few products for financing of businesses in general. And MSMEs particularly. MSMEs are part of course, businesses. For equipment financing, we had term loan. And for working capital financing, there are two kinds of working capital financing. One is indigenous businesses, and another is export and import financing, international trade financing.
Dr. Kumar, you got muted, and I request all the participants not to kindly hamper the flow of the event. Do not try to mute the speaker at all. Thank you.
So we had very, you know, standard products for work, for term loan, for financing of equipment, machinery, building, plant, anything which has repayment period of more than, you know, 1 year, we were giving term loan from bank with a repayment period of maybe 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, 5 year, maximum at the most 7 years. And then for working capital, as I said, we had two kinds of working capital financing, one for indigenous operations and another for international trade, import and export. So cash credit against inventory and book debts, stocks and book debts, and overdraft were the most prominent products, which were, you know, which even now also, of course, are the most popular products and mostly being used by the banking system for financing the businesses. Then we had some other products like composite loan. Now, composite loan is where you give a sort of a term loan, but it finances your equipment as well as your working capital together. Because when the requirement is not very high, you don't differentiate between, you know, even working capital also is financed by way of a, you know, a period loan, term loan, so that working capital is repaid over a period of time. So composite loan came into, I implemented this composite loan scheme in NSIC also, in fact. We were giving loans up to 25 lakhs, up to maximum of 25 lakhs to the MSMEs, those who needed only up to 25 lakhs. So composite loan became a very popular product. Then the other kinds of products also, of course, letters of credit and bank guarantees, deferred payment bank guarantees. These are contingent facilities which were being given by the banks. The purpose basically of all these credit facilities is to finance the business requirements of funding as far as equipment is concerned, and working capital resources as far as financing, you know, working capital is concerned. But over a period of time, with the innovative products coming, innovative ideas being generated, innovation having become the buzzword, and a lot of startups coming up. So even banking sector and the NBFC sector, financing sector also has undergone a lot of change. And various new products came. I remember I was part of a committee at the ministry. We were drafting the Factoring Act. And it was only, I think, 2011. Factoring was at that time considered to be a very new product. Although factoring as such has been utilized by many, financiers long time back. But when we were preparing the draft, we involved bankers and, other experts. And we thought as if we are doing a very great innovation, in fact, in the financing field. So that is how the Factoring Act came into practice. We will discuss about that aspect also. And then, of course, the various new products like, invoice financing has come. Invoice financing is basically where the invoices alone, individual invoices are financed. It is not booklet financing, it is invoice financing. Then a product called, which is very much in use, is cash flow financing. Now, cash flow financing is basically nothing but your future cash flows, which are expected to be earned by any business, whether it's a shop or a commercial establishment or an industry. So much so, even the credit card operations at the shop, which generate future cash receipts, are also being funded and financed and discounted. There is a lot of discounting of consumer financing receivables, because these are also future receivables which have to be recovered by the financing body or by the selling body. So these receivables are also being funded. So it's called receivable financing. Of course, receivable financing includes a lot of other things. Book debt financing is also a receivable financing. But then cash flow financing and invoice financing, and then there have been a lot of committees on this aspect to improve the flow of credit as well as to improvise on the kind of credit. So I remember starting from Tandon committee to Chore committee, and then those who are in the banking field must be aware, then Nayak committee, and then Gupta committee, Marathe committee, and then came Sil Kapoor committee. These are all committees which have been established either by the government or by Planning Commission, erstwhile Planning Commission, or by Reserve Bank of India, to work out, in fact, the flow of credit, to improve the flow of credit to the MSME sector particularly. Because this finance problem has been a rampant, issue which has been debated and talked about for ages. At least I am seeing this problem for the last 40 years that I am in the field of MSME financing and associated with MSMEs. So this problem has been addressed by various committees. There was a Prime Minister's Task Force in 2008-09. I was also associated with that. Then there is a recent committee set up by the Ministry of MSME, which is called Prabhat Kumar Committee, which also gave a lot of recommendations. I was advisor to that committee. So a lot of recommendations have been made with regard to how to improve the flow of credit and how to improve the kind of instruments so that it becomes very efficient financing. Even small one instrument which is generated. Now, what is TREDS? TREDS has come into practice. TREDS is a trade receivable discounting system. Now, TREDS has emanated from a recommendation of a committee. I think it was SINA committee, UK SINA committee probably. From there, the TREDS has emanated. And TREDS is working quite well. There have been other instruments which have come. Now, recently, the Finance Ministry announced two very important schemes in the COVID-19 stimulus package. One is fund of funds, that is basically to finance the equity, equity issues of the MSMEs. Now, what is equity issue by MSMEs? It's an innovative way of financing, meeting the funding requirement of the MSMEs. Other than credit, the MSMEs should be able to raise equity also from the market. What is venture fund? It's a new form of, you know, providing capital to the MSMEs. Angel funding is another, which was under a lot of debate in the earlier 2-3 years because of the angel tax which the government had stipulated. So that is another new instrument which has come about. Crowdfunding. Crowdfunding is, you know, I think most of you must be aware. Crowdfunding is very interesting model of, you know, meeting the requirements of any enterprise. So that is another instrument which has come. Even Power to SME, with which we are associated and is the organizer of this program, has come about new instruments of financing purchase of raw materials. So these are very innovative instruments which people are utilizing, MSMEs particularly are utilizing. So then there have been a host of new instruments. I was talking about the Ministry of Finance coming out with stimulus package and announcing two very important products. One is fund of funds for meeting the capital needs of the MSMEs, participation up to 15%. The fund of fund is going to meet 15% of the capital requirement of the MSMEs which go for listing. And second is very interesting, is more interesting than the first one, and that is distressed MSME fund. Distressed MSME fund is 1,000 crore, is basically a very, very innovative development, of a model. What is distressed fund is going to do is, the banks are going to fund distressed MSMEs which have defaulted and which have become NPAs. So they are eligible, but funding will not be done to the companies or the MSMEs directly by the banks. Banks will provide this loan to the promoters or the owners of that particular MSME to the extent of a limit up to 50 lakhs, I think is the limit, 50 lakhs. Or maybe 15% of their own capital or net worth which they have invested, maximum 15% or 50 lakhs. And this will be a personal loan to promoters. And the promoters are going to utilize this money. They can't do it for buying any personal assets or spending money on their personal use. They have to spend this money, utilize this money to put it into the company as capital. So this is called subordinated debt, which will remain subordinated until the dues of the bank are fully paid. So the condition is that this money will be utilized into the system, into that sick or distressed MSME, so that distressed MSME can improve their financial position. Maybe if they have to repay to the bank, they can repay to the bank also out of that. And this will make the company healthy, and that is how the NPA, they can come out of the the problem of the NPAs. So this is a very new instrument, which I was also quite pleased, in fact, to see that there are people who are always looking at something new and innovative. So I think these are some of the instruments which I thought, let me mention to you, if nothing is left out. Trades, invoice financing, venture funding, hybrid. The hybrid instruments is another. There is a funding by banks and NBFCs particularly, by way of hybrid instruments, that they finance loan and capital together in one go. And with retaining a flexibility that whether they would like to have a repayment of the loan or they will like to convert it into capital at a later stage if the unit becomes successful. So these are another kind of instruments which are being funded. External commercial borrowing, of course, has come about. It was known earlier also, but over a period of time, ECB also has become very popular, and government has making it easier for the businesses and MSMEs to avail the ECB. Suppliers credit and buyers credit, both. Of course, it have been these credit lines also have been prevalent in the past, and a lot of suppliers credit and buyers credit have been utilized and availed by people from Exim Bank, because Exim Bank provides lines of credit either for suppliers or for buyers. Zumer, there is a lot of change happening in the screen. I don't know who is disturbing. It distracts. So yes, can you please check that there is a lot of lot of changes happening on the screen. I think somebody
new joinees.
So these are some of the new instruments which I thought let me inform you. A host of instruments. We had only 6-7 instruments when I was a banker. Today there are 20 more instruments which have come, kinds of financing which have come. So what is important is not the kinds of instruments. What is important is meeting the requirements of the borrower, full requirements of the borrower, and without undue, you know, pressure in terms of structuring the financing, which can create problems at a later stage. If you finance, you know, factoring, the factoring has its own connotations and its own features. It should not result in, you know, at a later stage when you ask for book debts and the people do not have book debts. So this also has to be taken care of at the time of negotiating the credit terms and looking at the nature of credit, which banks and financial institutions and non-banking finance companies, a lot of non-banking finance companies, microfinance companies have come about in the country. And they are also expanding at a very fast pace. And I'm sure that in future, NBFCs are going to take a lead, in fact, in financing the small enterprises, micro enterprises, and MSMEs particularly. So with this introduction, which I have from the government side and from the industry, I would like to invite my expert, panelists who are available with us. First of all, of course, Mr. N.R. Jagadish, who is the General Secretary of CASIA, because he is in the field. He is himself as a very practical entrepreneur. He is more than 37 years, I think more than 25 years of experience, and is an entrepreneur and promoter of Janma Precisions, if I am rightly pronouncing it. Janma Precisions. Of course, a very versatile person, keeps keen interest in SME development, and keeps motivating the younger generation, in fact, to become job creators. I mean, it's a wonderful thought. We all in the government, as particularly I from the NSIC, have been doing it for a long time, and it is very close to my heart. Thank you, Mr. Jagadish, for doing this wonderful job and helping the society. And he also served as a managing council member of Peenya Industrial Association. It's a another very important industrial association of Karnataka. And he's a philanthropist and Rotary president, assistant governor and director, part of, and also a very important position, part of hospital development committee of Peenya ESI Hospital. He has been appointed by the government of India on this. I think very, very strong credentials. Mr. Jagadishan, over to you. Mr. Jagadish, can you hear me? Mr. Jagadish, can you hear me, please?
Mr. Jagadish, you are on mute. You need to unmute yourself.
Hello, can you hear me, sir?
Yes, yes, now I can hear you. So I was inviting you with a request that now we should have the expert. I have already talked about it.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Namaskara. I bring greetings from our president of CASIA, Sri K.B. Arsappa, and his office bearers, and all the members of CASIA. Around 11,500 members are there in CASIA. CASIA is an apex body representing 11,500 MSME and having more than 125 affiliated associations all over Karnataka. CASIA is a state level body which acts as a bridge between industry and government on matters related to policy formulation and development of MSMEs. CASIA has a long history of 70 years and functions on the democratic principles. CASIA fulfills its objectives through manifesto and its 27 exclusive panels. CASIA is an ISO 9001:2015 certified organization. CASIA represents on 28 committees of various departments, both in state and central government. CASIA has established help desk on MSME data bank, banking and finance, taxes, customs, excise, ESIC and PF. CASIA has brought out MSME handbook, information on Government of India, Government of Karnataka, and other schemes. So I am very happy to be part of this webinar, sir, of Power to SMEs on new and innovative ways of financing micro and small enterprises. This is an old subject that has bothered SMEs for a long time and will continue to worry them in all probability for years more.
Yes.
For one, it is in the nature of things. And secondly, the ecosystem is such, it is not easy to change, though we pretend to make changes. Small industries face multiple problems in accessing finance. The cost of money is unaffordable. Demand of collateral impossible to meet. Bank charges are too many. Procedures are cumbersome. Banks are generally unfriendly and suspicious. And what you get never comes in time. It's also true that successive governments have made sincere efforts to ease the problem. From priority funding to the latest emergency credit line for COVID-related funding. There have been continuing reforms and multiple schemes and products, but largely remain on paper. The ground realities are different. Therefore, whatever new comes will be welcome. There will have to be real new methods of addressing the problem. Really understanding the pain points and addressing those in a collective sense. The delivery is where they fail. Execution always been a problem. So what SME need in short are a few things such as collateral free loans, low interest loans, say 5 to 7%, bill financing, that is easy to access, equity, if you are able to assure in a new culture, a more focused SIDBI, SFCs that are better funded and administered, and of course, new products, innovative and easily accessed. I must tell you, mere jargons will not help. The problems are known, but must be understood and addressed. If need be through, use of better insights and leveraging technology. These are easier said than done, sir. I hope the seminar today will help improve our understanding of the issues and offer real alternatives. So all the best for the seminar, sir. Thank you, sir.
Oh, very well, very well. Very crisp and very clear. Thank you, Mr. Jagdish. I think you have been so perfect in assessing the current situation of the SME financing and also giving suggestions with regard to what exactly is required. I take three issues which you mentioned very briefly: the cost, the procedures, and the attitude. I think you summed up everything into this. The cost, yes, cost of seeking loan, cost of borrowing loan, cost of procedures, that is one part. And procedures is another part. A lot of documentation, lot of running around, lot of, you know, projections, financial statements, guarantees, collaterals, all these go into procedures. And third, of course, you very rightly mentioned about the attitude. The bankers have to have a positive attitude to help the MSMEs particularly. And why MSMEs alone? All the borrowers. Ultimately, they are contributing to the economy of the country. So while the government is very keen, as you rightly mentioned, the government is very keen, government is taking initiative, government is announcing various steps. This COVID stimulus package also is an indication of the government's intention, but it doesn't translate fully to the, you know, people who are intended to be the beneficiaries. So that is the problem. You know, in transition, there are a lot of hassles and difficulties. So that aspects need to be taken care of. And your suggestion that technology can play a role, I fully agree with that. Technology, of course, has helped in various other areas in banking. While the banking operations and the day-to-day, day-to-day operations of the banks have been fully computerized, we have a lot of ease in dealing with saving bank and current account and all these things, drawing money and ATMs.
but then for assessing the independent assessment of a borrower's need, I think technology can play a great role, which is still not being done. It is only discretion which is working. The minds of the people are deciding whether they want to give the loan to you or not, whether they want a collateral from you or not. What is the, so all these also can be, you know, done through technology, and I'm sure the artificial intelligence, AI and IoT in future are going to certainly help. Let me bring in your colleague, Mr. Suresh Sagar, who is the chairman of the banking committee of CASIA. I think he is the one who has been dealing with banks and both sides, of course, banks also and the industry also. It's a huge, huge, you know, association, Karnataka Small Scale Industry Association, CASIA. And I'm sure that he must be confronting with a lot of issues. So over to you, Mr. Sagar, for your, you know, opening address.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon to all. But at the very outset, I once again salute to Mr. Kumarji.
Thank you.
And the other speakers. And now I come to the subject. Sir, this is like a, in our body, we have a physiological system, all circulatory systems. This blood circulation is also very important, like how the money is required in our functioning of units. So this is very, very important. One of the aspects should be considered like a blood, number one. And then I mean, my own doubts. I'm quite skeptic about the professionalism lies in MSME sector. I mean, lenders, I'm especially targeting at the lenders, whether the lenders have a professionalism in financing the MSME, right? MSMEs. That's the one. For example, I can give you one example. In the agriculture sector, farmers get the loan through that local society, that the agriculture primary society, whatever we call it. That particular society consists of the directors, all are farmers. One cannot go and bluff, saying that I'm doing blah, blah, all that. Because all the directors sitting in that agriculture society are also farmers. Means they have got some professionalism in their sector. So do we have that kind of a system in MSME? Only CDB is there, fine. I accept it. One branch manager who is an engineering graduate or something else, or may not be engineering, a civil graduate, who does not know much about the engineering industry. So then he will forward it to the MSME wing. It is for the freshers I am talking. See, here there are four type of borrowers. One is the exporters, the another is a existing borrower, the third one is a unit functioning without availing finance from the bank. There are industries who are running on their own with their own funds. They are not availed a loan from the banker, but during COVID, lot of people went to the bank, but they couldn't get that facility as they expected. That's one. And freshers. So they're the four type. One is the exporters, existing borrowers, and owners without availing the loan. I mean, current, they are maintaining the current account, but not availed the loan. The fourth category is the fresher startup. So how do we go about it? Like all these four functions, I mean, four categories. How do we go about it? This is very, very important. It is challenging for the bankers, because bankers have to rise to the occasion, because now the people are aware that because of the COVID, we are really into a big stress. So in order to bring some kind of a fillip or an oxygen to the MSME, the government of India has brought this ECLGs, that's the emergency credit line guarantee scheme, and then brought by the government of India. It's a wonderful scheme, but there are some lacunae in this particular scheme. One is that, as I mentioned earlier, the unit is functioning without availing the loan so far before COVID. Because of COVID, they are having some problem now, some kind of a hiccup. In order to get out of that, they require a finance, immediate finance. It is not that what is happening now, the bankers, when they go there, they say they are busy with this ECLG scheme, blah, blah, and all that. They are not encouraged. Why? They should be, you should give a, I mean, corporate welcome, red corporate welcome, because they have been managing without the banking fund. Means they are very healthy. Its financial position is very healthy. Why not the bankers support immediately? You know, they are also, I mean, might be in a very good position. Like, there are companies who are doing 10 crore, 15 crore without availing single pie from the bank. Now they have come. So these bankers should encourage. And other one is, existing borrowers are getting only SMA 0, SMA 1 categories are getting the loan as per the, under this particular scheme. What about the SMA 2? As Mr. Kumarji mentioned, this subordinate debt, we call it the CGSSD, Credit Guarantee Scheme for Subordinate Debt, has been introduced by the Government of India, but it is taking a very, very long time to implement. Till now, it is not implemented by the banker. Recently, CDB has sent the circular to all the bankers to, have their own, system, guidelines. Guidelines to give a loan under subordinate debt. I mean, bring the NPA category accounts out of the bracket or SMA 2, stressed loan. These two categories should be brought out. Then whether will they be eligible to avail a fund under ECLGS is a question mark. It is not very clear in that particular guidelines issued by the CDB. Now, anyway, it has already reached all the bankers. Now the bankers are doing the rounds on the guidelines. I want the guidelines to come out as early as possible, so that lot of units which fallen under SMA 2 and NPA categories can come out to the mainstream and avail fresh loan and start functioning, so that unemployment creation will be avoided some extent. They need not sack anybody. They can continue their business with the fresh fund. This is very, very important, but it is being delayed. I regret to inform that in this particular platform. And then this, we were talking about the exporters, the exporters finance. So now, as you are aware, that because of this China and all these problems, we are going to have an upper hand. India, definitely, we are going to rule in the export. In order to encourage this exports unit, or in order to bring people to the export category, I mean, bring them into the export business, there are a lot of units. They are not so much worried or not interested in the export business. Now is the time that all these experts bring them to the export business, apart from domestic. That's the one way of increasing the export. The another way, the existing exporters should get the finance, easily, without getting into any kind of hassles. This too to be encouraged. Apart from that, there are freshers, as I earlier mentioned, and under four category. These freshers, see, recently I read one paper wherein a doctor and a scientist involved and started manufacturing ventilators. Good, fantastic quality oriented ventilators. So they should be immediately brought to the commercial production, and they should be encouraged to start exporting. Why? Those freshers immediately should be called by the expert committee, whosoever, the MSME expert committee or whatever. They should be called and ask them to start the commercial production and start exporting, apart from fulfilling our domestic needs. These all the things should be on the war foot basis. If that is not done, definitely, again, we will remain as we were, and again China will take over. In case we want to be a vibrant and a war foot basis, every department, every sector, MSME, finance, labor, there are a lot of things are going on. I accept in the labor recently there are some kind of regulations have been brought in the labor law. And NCLT is there, IBC is there, even it is also a kind of a boon to the Indian economy, recent introduction of all this. However, these things should go on a war foot basis. Then only MSME can flourish, MSME can start exporting. And whatever we say that 45% of the export is done by the MSME, 40% of the GDP is contributed by the MSME, all these things will prove. We may go up to 70%. I'm very sure if all things are encouraged by each and every department, MSME will go to the higher scale. That's the one. And recent definition in MSME, I felt that there's a 250 crore, 100 crore to immediately it is scaled up to 250 crore. I strongly feel these micro and medium scale industries do not get the proper share in the scheme. Unless until the MSME department excludes the schemes, there should be a separate allocation for the medium and micro. Otherwise, it will be eaten away by the medium scale because you made it 250 crore now. It was 100 crore. The 1:5. 20 crore, 100 crore. 20 crore is the plant and machinery, 100 crore is the turnover. Now you made it 50 crore and 250 crore. I, as a MSME member, it's my personal opinion, that's not ideal. They should have kept it 100, or else you please make a exclusive in the scheme, whatever you bring the scheme, allot major percentage 60-70% to the micro and small, which are very badly in need of this. The medium can survive. So this is my feeling as far as this MSME definition concerned. And then if you come to this, Kumar sir was talking about the what kind of other alternatives to the MSMEs. Sir, one is the credit insurance. Actually, these general insurance companies were operating earlier, kind of a credit insurance. Suppose I give a credit to one particular industry, something. So now, especially COVID, anything may happen. The owner may shut down. The owner may not be there, or something may happen. This is the today's current situation is like that. If that is the case, I say one fellow has to get a major amount from one particular debtor. That debtor is no more. Then what about this industry? So there should be a credit insurance scheme should be brought back with the simplified nature. It should be simplified, because they were having lot of conditions, this general insurance, saying that there should be turnover should be more than 10 crore, blah, blah, all that. I'm not very clear about their regulations. However, this credit insurance kind of an scheme should be brought back by the government, ensure that all their credit is protected. This unit, whatever we supply, we should get back our payment in case of some kind of a unnatural incident. One unit should not suffer. They should get it through the insurance. This should be meant for the all this micro and small. It should be there. And then, sir, you are again one more alternative tricks. You have already mentioned trade irreceivable discounting system. What is happening in this? Anyway, let's forget this COVID scheme. COVID this parade. Earlier also, it was introduced around 3 years ago. If I'm right, correct me if I'm wrong. This, what happened all these 3-4 years? Earlier said Gondli government, then private sector, above 500 crore turnover companies can, should be brought under TEDS platform. Then they are the buyers. We MSME are the sellers. Fine. This buyer, 500 crore and above turnover companies, large scale companies, are not registering with the TEDS. Even if they register, they are not active. Then how do we go about it? The government should take some kind of a firm steps, ensure that there should be a compulsory registration on this platform, number one. Number two, you should get activated. Everybody should take part. In this, bankers have got a major role. See, bankers, say example, a particular bank is maintaining an account of ABB or XYZ big companies. They should insist that this particular company should get into the TEDS platform. They should encourage, nobody else.
Yes, yes, yes. I agree, Mr. Sagar. I think you are making very, very, very
sir, strong. I'll finish.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, I thought let me bring in our other
guest also. I am coming back to you after.
Yeah, please.
We are very happy about your suggestions. I am so happy that you have given a wonderful suggestion of credit insurance.
I got some more.
I know that credit insurance has been a very, very big issue. And while government has introduced credit guarantees, and you know, but even then, nothing like credit insurance. And in many other countries, credit insurance is highly prevalent. Your other suggestions also, I'll come back to you, in fact, with whatever is remaining with you, so that we listen. And I am noting down all these suggestions. And whenever I have the opportunity of meeting the ministry, I am surely going to discuss these and talk to them. But one more point which I would like to highlight, and is very important, I will take it up, is the professional approach of the bankers. They are not, you know, professionally trained. They are not professionally trained to deal with all kinds of sectors. Like you gave the example of agriculture, primary societies, where it's only the experts who are dealing with agricultural credit. Similarly, in the banking sector, the branch manager, they are not able to deal with industries. And the industry also, you know, hundreds of kinds of industries, different clusters. So that is a point which I have noted down. Of course, there are other issues that you have mentioned, but two things I have noted down. And the third is definition that you said, medium has been taken at a very high level. There should be a separate dispensation of any assistance which is made available to MSME sector for the medium. I take this point, I have noted down, and that also is a very, very important takeaway from today's deliberations. I think you have given a 3 or 4 very important suggestions which I have noted down. So I'll get back to you for remaining ones. Please be ready. Meanwhile, let me bring Mr. Kugel, who is from Delhi. He has been waiting. Sorry, Mr. Kugel. In fact, we wanted to have a complete picture of the, you know, what is happening around in the MSME sector and understand as to what exactly is the current situation and how do we take it forward. So Mr. Kugel is the Associate Vice President of Delhi Solutions, and more than 37 years of experience in the field of various, you know, I was reading your profile. I think you are you have a lot of knowledge about, you know, various sectors of the businesses, including, you know, as a faculty trainer in the GST, and you have taken sessions in, you know, for ICAI Dubai, and various sessions in Abu Dhabi, Jebel Ali, and prior to Delhi, you have been practicing in sales tax. So you are an expert on income tax and GST and, you know, these IT solutions. So it is always a pleasure to talk to such people who can provide a lot of services to the MSMEs. So over to you, Mr. Kugel. Mr. Kugel, you are muted.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And I really appreciate the earlier speakers who gave, you know, very, very good suggestions and great suggestions. Now, my theme of today's presentation is basically going to be, one is, yes, there is external finance. The second is something, whatever money that you have in your organization, how are you able to track those money? How are you able to track those, you know, your cash flow and other things? So I should not take more than about 10 minutes. I have a very small presentation, so I'll just present now. Yes, I think you are able to see my presentation.
Yes, yes. Please go ahead.
Yes. Okay, fine. So basically, the theme is that how do you remodel your finances from within your resources that you have? So the question that we need to ask is basically, where is the money, right? So I mean, we are well aware that money saved is money earned. So what are the different remodeling of finances that the user can do within their own organization? I represent Delhi Solutions. We have been a technology partner for especially the MSME segment for over 33 years. and we have been providing technology solution to majority of the MSMEs in our country and across the world. So basically for managing the finance, so what we feel is that, you know, these are the three very important critical thing today, especially in this COVID pandemic. It is very, very important, very critical for us to see how we are able to manage our cash flows. Number two is, what are the measures that you can bring to cut cost in your organizations? And definitely this pandemic in the last almost 3 months, it has definitely given us a wake-up call, saying that, you know, technology is going to play a very important role. Today we are gathered here because of the technology and how technology is able to bring people. Even though we are not able to meet in person, we are able to meet, discuss, and then, you know, do a lot of things. So choosing the right technology at this point in time is very, very critical. Now, managing the receivable, if you see, what are those important things that you can do in managing the receivable? One is that, do you have a default credit period? So in fact, you know, if you're using a business solution software, for example, let us assume that you are using Tally software. So what are the things that you can do? You have, and almost any software that you are using today should have these features and functionalities, which I think now it is time for MSMEs to start leveraging the technology that they are using and get the maximum out of it, so that they have a better fund flow, cash flow management. So one is that, you know, how do you can you have a default credit period set, so that, you know, you are able to, so that you are able to track the receivables on a daily basis. And number two is, can you also specify credit limit? If you know, okay, these are the customers, you know, basically now you will do a due diligence of your customer, and based on the due diligence you have done with the customer, if you are able to fix a credit limit. By fixing a credit limit, what happens is, basically, if the person's outstanding is due, and if you are trying to make an invoice subsequently, and if the amount is exceeding the credit limit that is there, the software should allow you to stop. In fact, in Tally, you can stop it. So that way, what happens, you have a tracking of your outstanding with your customers. The next is that, during entry, if there are any bill which are outstanding, you should have the visibility, so that you can instantly take a decision and see whether, you know, you need to, you know, do further supply, or do you need to get a commitment from the customer and then probably supply. And the other most important thing that many of the MSMEs today, what I've seen out of my experience in my past meetings and sessions, is that one very important thing that we lose track of is the invisible cost, or the sunken cost, like the amount which are overdue. What is the loss of interest? See, today we are talking about the finances where, you know, basically majority of us, you know, take finances, you know, through bank or non-banking financial corporation, NFBCs, but then, you know, you pay interest on the money that you have borrowed, and any sales that you are doing on a credit is basically you are giving capital to your customer. And if the money is not coming within the credit period, what is the amount of interest? Because one, you pay interest on your borrowed capital, and second, you are providing capital to somebody without any interest. So these are some of the things which is definitely required for you to be on top of it and see whether you are able to find out what is the loss on return of investment that is actually eating up your bottom line. So these are some very important things that is required now and always. And the next important aspect is that, basically, the cash projections. Are you on top of your cash flow? I mean, like month on month, are you prepared enough to see that you have enough working capital? So what happens, in fact, if you take Tally as I'm taking Tally as an example, if you are able to manage your outstanding receivables properly with your proper credit limit and with your proper credit days and tracking of your outstanding, then automatically you will have your cash flow projections. One is your cash flow projections of your receivable and payable is one thing that you are going to get. But the most important thing is that you will have so many other expenditure which are fixed in nature or recurring in nature. So you can, I mean, like using the software, you can now provide them as as a provisional transaction, and those provisional, even though you are not actually paying those provisional transactions, if you are able to bring it into your cash flow, you get a better idea of month on month what is the position of your cash and what action is required for you. Either you know, you follow up with your receivable, or are you prepared to now go in for additional funding. Right. So these are something which definitely helps you by click of a button. I mean, like, you know, your software that you are using should give you this information so that you are able to take informed decision during crisis time. The next is basically the optimization of inventory. Again, the more inventory you hold for a longer time is what is the sunken cost or the blockage of your working capital. Any business solution software that you are using, these are some questions that you need to ask. What are my items that I'm holding, whether they are fast moving, slow moving, or non-moving? Next is, what is the profit margin that you're getting on a particular product? You are dealing in 15-20 products. Now, which product gives you better margin? Are you on top of it? Do you have that information? Or if you're raising an invoice to a particular customer, have you really made profit out of those sales that you have made? Do you have a visibility? Basically, your software that you are using should give you this information at a click of a button. The next is, what are your committed supplies? Do you have enough quantity of your goods with you so that you are able to meet your commitment? And today, especially with this pandemic, and you know, I mean, like, the businesses are really in almost like a pause mode, it is very important that we are able to now serve our customer very, very critical. So do you know what are your committed supplies that are there? Now, based on your committed supply, do you know what quantity you need to be ordered? And for that, basically, you need to see what are your reorder level. How can you set up a reorder level? What are the minimum order that are there? This whole thing, finally, what happens, it ends up with you having a just-in-time stock so that you save on your sunken cost of your holding inventory. Now, to summarize, it is very important that all of our MSMEs today, these are the three mantras that we have to really, really keep in mind. One is that, yes, we have to be awakened with all those things that is happening and see how are we going to prepare ourselves to face those challenges and arise and, you know, take forward your business and basically act upon your decision that you are taking. Whatever is the decision, right decision you are taking, you act upon it, and let's sail through this one of the worst crisis situation of the century. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Poovel. Very crisp and very clear address. Awake, arise, and act. I think these are the three mantras. And Tally Solutions, in any case, is a very prominent product around the country. Tally has done a wonderful job, in fact, particularly with the small businesses. Yes. I think millions of small businesses have taken advantage of Tally's solutions, particularly the accounting software. And now, of course, with the improvement in products of Tally, Tally has come out with, you know, ERP solutions also, like, yes, you mentioned about receivables management, inventory management. And what I liked was, you know, the cash flow management. The cash flow projections become so important in any business that without the proper projections, which of course Tally should be able to help in making those projections, I think you can't run a business, even a small business worth, you know, like micro enterprise is now 5 crore turnover. Now 5 crore turnover also requires a good amount of, you know, like cash flow management.
Absolutely.
Accounting management, inventory management. Because inventory in 5 crore turnover would be not less than 1 crore. If you say 1 crore of inventory, you need some kind of a software. And I'm sure I have seen Tally myself, in fact. The Tally is a very wonderful software, standardized and most economical. So I think your address is quite useful, and you have given the features of the Tally, which I'm sure going to take advantage. Now, coming back to I think let me bring in Mr. Jagdish first. Jagdish sir, are you with me? Are you able to hear me? Mr.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, really, sir.
So I thought, let me bring you again for a minute into the conversation. What do you think, any change which is required in the COVID stimulus package? Of course, I have heard Mr. Sagar also talking about some of the things, but specifically one or two things which you think are required to be changed in that stimulus package for COVID-19, which the finance ministry has announced.
My colleague Suresh will answer.
So coming to Mr. Suresh, so
yes, sir.
I think you have given a very good suggestions. So I think there were some points left out. If you can complete them, please.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So this is, I think you are talking about this emergency credit link, yes, guarantee scheme.
Yes.
This particular scheme, the lacuna in this SMA-2, they should have made it at least 90 days instead of 60 days. Because before COVID, there were a lot of units, I mean, especially this automobile sector and real estate sectors were already in a declining trend. Those units, okay, after COVID again, they got more affected. They're, in fact, they're almost down, including our this one, hotel sector, hotel industry, and this tourism and all that, you are well aware of it. But I'm talking about the MSME, automobile sector, and real estate sector were already down. So they were unable to get the finance under this particular scheme because they come under SMA 2. So what about those units? They should get up at least, start making, maybe another 6 months, it may start improving. That particular sector definitely start making sound after 6 months. So how do they survive till that time? Don't you feel that they require a finance to, stand, at least to leave, stay till another 6 months? So this not included in this particular scheme, they should have included in this. That's my this one.
No, I think it's a good suggestion. We'll take it up. In fact, you mean,
yes, sir.
SME 2 is not included. It's only, yes, SME 0 and SME 1 are included.
SME
norms are 90 days. Why have they reduced it to 60 days for availing this, emergency credit? So it's a very good point. I have noted down.
Thank you, sir. Based on this finance, they should have gone up to 30. Actually, before this ECLGS scheme, they had introduced 10% on the working capital, straight 10% on the working capital that was introduced. Canara Bank made 30% on that. But again, they withdrew the scheme after the introduction of this ECLGS. They stopped that particular scheme. That 30% have been more ideal compared to 20%. Now, 20% what they have made, they should have made it 30% instead of 20. That's my opinion.
No, good point.
And then, as I told you, this NBFC and these private bankers, MNCs, they are not encouraging this scheme. We have on and again, we have been requesting all the Reserve Bank of India and all MSME department saying that you should insist MNC and NBFC to come forward to fund for MSME under this particular scheme. This scheme is eligible for NBFC. The scheme is for MNC also, but they are not coming forward. So you mean to say that people who are having, MSME units who are having accounts with these MNC banks, they should get deprived of this? Why they should be deprived of the scheme? Why can't they operate? Why can't they come forward and help at this particular juncture, this COVID? They never asked. All these days they were maintaining, they were paying interest to the bank. But now they are in problem because of COVID. These bankers should come forward. Apathy, sympathy, whatever you say, that should be made now. No, not after that.
Right.
That's the one. And then this, sir, this is regarding this venture capital. These startup units, I feel not only startup units, there are, and this venture capital, I think a good lot of rich people are enrolled in this, including our software agents like our Sri Narayan Murthy ji, Sri Neil Kanesh ji, all those people are having a kind of a venture capital. They should also come forward to finance for other kind of a manufacturing, not only just a software, they should come forward, even to say, example, people who want to manufacture ventilator, people who want to manufacture some innovative product to export, or maybe agriculture products. I mean, it's my feeling. They should also come forward to, fund them under VC, venture capital. So that's the one. And then maintenance of these datas. These data are not at all maintained. Some people say there is a 11 crore MSM unit. Some people say 6 crore MSM unit. So 11 crore employment and there are 6 crore MSME. How can only two members in particular unit? How can it be? There are a lot of units employed, more than 10, more than 5 in micro units. Then that doesn't tally at all. So this, even the company like Tally, definitely they can. They can maintain this data very well because they'll know like who are operating, MSMEs and all that. So this turnover below 5 crore, how many companies? 10 crore. They get promoted from 5 crore to 10 crore. Like that, these data, we are lacking in that. That's why the schemes are not reaching the beneficiaries, eligible beneficiaries. So these things should happen. This maintenance of data in the MSME sector is very, very important, but it is not taking place. I request you to convey this to the concerned department and there should be some kind of strategy to maintain the proper MSME data. That's the one. And then we were talking about this SME stocks. That's again equity floating. Here the government has come forward to invest 15% once I go to the SME stock. But I feel there's a bit premature to discuss on this at this particular subject now, because now this one is a breathing, and then we can get into all the stock market and other things. And then this NPA 180 days. This 180 days NPA should be properly brought into, because now the Basel norms 2 should have implemented last year March 2019. It got postponed again now because of COVID. I don't want that Basel norms to come to India because we are not suitable to implement that Basel norm. So that should not be brought here now. Though the international, we are into the international banking regulation, still I feel that Basel norms should not be implemented this year, or maybe another 2-3 years should be postponed. That's the one. And in every platform, I keep reiterating that CIBIL is managed by a foreign company, TransUnion. This company is managing our CIBIL. Our borrower's rate, credit score, I'm not talking about the rating. Credit scoring is done by CIBIL. Why there should be some kind of a entity, foreign entity, to maintain our data? Why not our own Reserve Bank of India or central government constitute our own scoring agency instead of depending on somebody else? We don't follow any other scoring agency. We always follow CIBIL.
Okay.
But let's look at that foreign entity.
You have a host of information. I think I should get in touch with you personally outside this seminar.
I thought it's a platform. You allow me, you give me a chance to.
You have
a person to go to the government and tell this.
Yes, yes. No, I think these are all very important points. Two points again I have noted down. You have given a lot of points because some of the issues we have already taken up with the government earlier. Yes, but one point that 90 days to 60 days, which has been reduced. That is very important because they should be restored to 90 days, and all those SME2 also should be made eligible for emergency credit line. That is a very important point. Regarding the data issue that you mentioned, I think the data issue has been a problem all through, even when I was also there in the ministry and as the chairman. So this data has never been compiled accurately. It's only a presumption based on the estimates of a small survey, which is done by the government authorities. So based on surveys, they extrapolate. But your observation that 6 crore 30 lakhs enterprises are there, and you have only 11 crore and 30 lakhs employees, gives an average of only 2 employees per SEB. So which doesn't seem to be correct and doesn't match with the data. It's a very important observation. We will surely take it up with the government. But government also probably doesn't have any wherewithal to, you know, correctly estimate unless they do a country-wide survey, which of course is very cost involved. So what they are doing is probably now what they are doing is they are depending upon this Udyam Aadhaar, the new, you know, portal which has started for registration of MSMEs, and based on that probably they feel that over a period of time they will be able to get accurate data. But my point is that data of Udyam Aadhaar will be only partially be available, because only those MSMEs which get registered will be available. But what about the millions of unregistered MSMEs, informal MSMEs, small micro enterprises? I think as of today also there are 5 crore informal enterprises which are not registered. So how will that data be captured? So that is a big issue. We have been in fact grappling with this problem, how to collect data. I have not been able to find any answer, nor the government has this answer. But we will surely, this important issue is important, we will flag this issue. So I think we have discussed a lot. Unless Mr. Pugal wants to have something, I think one issue that I wanted to talk to Mr. Pugal was, how is Tally Solutions helpful in GST, filing of returns in GST?
Yes, sir. In fact, in our Tally ERP solution software, we have a GST module where the user can very quickly configure the GST rate, then HSN or SAC code, and normally capture the transaction, just the purchase entry, sale entry. By doing that, and the most important thing is configuration. Once you have done, it is very easy and very simple. Once it is done, the moment Tally user passes a purchase entry or a sale entry, automatically the relevant information which are required to be captured in the relevant form gets automatically captured. So GSTR1 in each of the table, like B2B, B2C, large, B2C, small, every information gets captured. In GSTR3B, the information gets captured. And over and above that, before the user is going to file the return, Tally is going to give a return summary, which is basically a reconciliation statement, which is going to ensure that the data that is captured and the data that is going to be uploaded into the portal are 100% as per the requirement of the government's requirement. So all this validation, everything is done, and all the user needs to do is just by click of a button, he can generate a JSON file, log into the GST portal and upload. So GST filing should not take more than, whether there are 50 entries or whether there are 5,000 entries, the filing of GST return should not take more than 15 minutes for the users who are using Tally module.
Good. I think it's a good facility. I think many of the MSMEs must be using it also. And it's better that you have explained, and people have come to know about this. So we come to the, I think we have discussed all these important issues about the subject today. So I would like to go back to Zumer and Sodamini. In case they have any questions, then we can take up those questions. Sodamini?
Sir, Sodamini is not available today, so I'll be putting the questions. Yes. Venkat Raman, he has an observation, not question exactly. He's saying, during these COVID times, banks, though directed to provide loans to MSMEs, some banks insisted on hard copies, even now. No forward-looking approach. This is his observation, general observation towards the banking attitude.
I think this takes us to, again, to the issue that was raised by our panelist today,
Mr. Sagar.
Sagar, I think Mr. Jagdish. Mr. Sagar, that people are not fully professionally, you know, tuned and trained, even at the branches level also, so that they should be able to, you know, go with the times and adopt for this digital means also. I think it's an observation which probably may be correct.
A participant from by the name Mahatex, it is saying raw material facilities from NSIC is not so effective as they asked 100% bank guarantee, and any other industries having cash credit limit find to utilize NSIC facilities only. So
let me answer this. Of course, NSIC is your position. But then, you see, NSIC is not a bank. NSIC doesn't run a financing model. Basically, what they do is only providing raw material. They sell the raw material. And they sell the raw material like Steel Authority, Indian Oil, GAIL, and BHEL. You know, they sell the material against either advance payment or LC or bank guarantee. So NSIC doesn't ask for advance payment, because then advance payment also is difficult for the MSMEs to pay, because Steel Authority will not give you steel without taking advance. NALCO will not give you aluminium without taking advance. So RINL will not give you material without even depositing the money first and then even allowing you to enter. And so what NSIC does is has simplified for selling the material on credit. They keep a standby bank guarantee for a year. And in that, you know, against that guarantee, you can continue to operate, take the material, deposit whatever money you have, and then accordingly this operation, it's a business model which NSIC has. It doesn't run like a bank, where the working capital facility is granted by the bank to the MSMEs. Next.
CA Ajay Gulati, he is saying, how fund of funds work and which is the nodal agency for it?
Fund of fund is yet to start, because government has made the announcement. Government has decided to contribute 10,000 crore and 40,000 crore will still be mobilized from other institutions. This fund of fund will be set up. The operating agency and the, you know, the anchoring agency is yet to be decided. I have requested the government that they should set up under their supervision, not the earlier like fund of funds which was given earlier to an institution, but it has not taken off much. Yes.
Mr. Venkatraman again has raised a question about would it be appropriate by a bank to put a precondition to close one bank for us to enjoy the enhanced credit limit in this particular bank?
I didn't get the question. Can you repeat?
Mr. Venkat, can you ask the question on voice? Will it be possible for you?
Question. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, yes. Please go ahead.
Sir, this is Venkatraman. Apart from whatever observations Mr. Zumer has told, I have a few more, but then that I will keep it aside. There were certain wonderful insights came into this discussion today. My question is, I have been already enjoying a CC limit with one of our bankers, and that has been going on for the last, say, 10-15 years. The banker says, yes, I have another banker with whom I have not taken any facility. When I opened this bank account, I opened another bank account with another nationalized bank. But now this bank says, yes, you are enjoying the CC limits with me, with the interest being paid on time, everything being done on time. He says, if I have to give an enhanced CC limits to you, you as a precondition, you close that bank account.
The bank account with other bank.
Yes, sir. I gave an example to him. Suppose in this technology age, I have got two SIM cards. Oh, the Vodafone and Airtel. I may use two phones. He agreed to that, but still it went to the higher ups. There is no forward looking. They say if you want to enjoy the enhanced CC limits, you have to close the other bank account.
Yeah, I think that is the practice of the banks generally. Your problem is genuine. I think I understand the problem. But as of today, let me tell you, the scenario is that each bank wants exclusive banking with the borrower. Why do they want this? And they want you to close the other accounts. Why do they want this? Because they don't want charge over the current assets, that is the stocks and booklets, by two bankers. Because if there are two bankers financing the same unit, there is going to be charge on security on current assets and working capital assets by two banks or even more banks, which they don't want. They want exclusive security so that they can monitor and control. That is the system prevailing as of now. But I agree with you that with the digital age coming, it should be possible, in fact, for multiple financing, multiple bank financing, and segregation of working capital assets, security, so that each bank has its own charge on current assets. Yes, Zumer.
Sir, the last question for today is by Mr. Raghav. He's saying, we have a cash credit loan with SBI. We have pledged a commercial property worth 2 crores of rupees, and they have sanctioned a loan of only 7.5 lakhs. They are not increasing our limits. The website psbloanin59minutes.com does not seem to be functional. What should be done now?
Actually, since he has enough security worth 2 crores and he needs more funding, more than 7.5 lakh, I think there is some disconnect. He can get it anywhere from any other bank. Let him close the account with State Bank of India. Not before he gets the, and talk to some other bank. I think the private sector banks and other nationalized banks would be too willing to give him any amount up to at least up to 1 crore, if not 2 crore. And then he can, after the sanction, he can transfer the new sanction and close the other account with State Bank of India. I'm sure when he gets the sanction from any other bank, even State Bank of India will also come forward and enhance the limit. So any other questions, Umay?
Sir, one just a small clarification is being asked about 2-3 times here. The bankers are still not following the new definition of MSME. So is there any kind of way forward to it? Is there any kind of scenario around this? Why they are not considering the revised definition of MSME?
No, in fact, Ministry of MSME has already issued the notification that new definition will be applicable from 1st of July. And similarly, RBI has also issued a notification to all the banks that this new definition should be taken into account. So I don't see any reason why the banks or any branch manager is not able to, understand the notifications issued by the ministry as well as by RBI. He should complain and he should take it up with the controlling office of that bank and try to, tell them why this problem is being faced. Yes, please go ahead. Somebody is raising hand. Yes. Yes, please.
Can I talk? Myself, Sandeep.
Yes, Sandeep, please go ahead.
Yeah. Good sir, good webinar, good information you have given. I will take 2 minutes. Hi, Mr. Jagdish, he's a good friend of mine. Hi, Suresh Sagar. Sir, my few observation on this GECL loan.
Yes.
This is given, this says on 29th, the credit as of outstanding as on 29th February. Normally what happens is with the month end, we bring money to pay our salaries. Always you utilize less on month end. So it is very unfair. So average credit of average 6 months or something has to be given. That is one point. Second one, they said is a pre-approved. Pre-approved and disbursement, there is a huge gap is there between these two. They're taking 2 or 3 months to disburse the loan. And they are giving us, of course, I agree that it is at a very competitive rate, but what for? I have to pay the salaries, statutory dues, and my creditors' payment. And at the end of the day, I can't take anything for me. Nothing is for me. Even if our salaries also, banks are saying is not allowed in GECL loan. And another is the big problem here entrepreneurs may face in the future is this loan is for 36 months. The repayment will be huge in the future. So it has to be enhanced at least 5 years. One more problem is they are asking a mortgage. They are asking a mortgage. They are extending a mortgage. Again, you have to pay the 0.3% of your stamp duty fees. That is also is unfair. So that's not my answer. Thank you very much.
4 or 5 questions that you have raised. I have all the questions in my mind now. The issues have been very, very raised by many others also. First of all, it has to be automatic because that is what I think the finance minister mentioned. It is automatically we approved. The problem is in implementation. The guidelines are very clear. The issue is of implementation when the branches and the banks, do not go for strict implementation of the guidelines. And the other issue that you raised regarding the outstanding of 29th. Some of them may not have utilized on 29th, so average should be taken. I think it's an important point, we'll take it up. And mortgage, in any case, they should not be asking because it's a mortgage-free loan, as Finance Minister has clearly mentioned. If they have existing mortgage, then they will get it extended for the additional facility also. You don't have to give, a new mortgage. But if you already created the mortgage, I think that can be extended. I think I can give last word to Mr. Sagar. I think he wants to say something and then we will close. Mr. Sagar, please.
My
Sir, my friend Mr. Parothikar was talking about this mortgage. Sir, in this particular scheme, NCGTC is another trust, as you know. This trust has taken a responsibility of this particular scheme. Under this NCGTC, it is very clear that this particular 20% whatever is being given is covered under insurance. 100% insurance covered by NCGTC. However, under this Paripasu clause, it should be registered so that it is attached to the present collateral or whatever you are given. That is the creation of asset. So, example, I have taken it under CGTMSC. I might not have given any collateral. Fine. Even it is attached to my present liability, whatever asset creation. So this is attached to it, no doubt. But banker should not demand any kind of a mortgage or any kind of a collateral for this particular ELCG scheme. That's wrong, actually. If the branch manager or anybody is demanding, it is wrong, because every bank has issued the general guidelines to the branch manager that can be given to our friend Mr. Parothikar. In case he wants it, he can write to Kasia. We will definitely help him out, or in his case, any friends are interested, he can ask them to approach Kasia. We will give them a guidelines. Every bank has sent the guidelines, we will give them that.
So I thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sagar, for this clarification. And it's a great assurance that you are giving from Kasia. I think the member can surely take it. So I think we come to the close of this very interesting. Yes. You want to say something? Hello? You are muted.
One more, sir. Unmute. I'm happy to say that our Karnataka government, this particular scheme in Karnataka implemented, we have already lent around 369 crore under this particular ECLG scheme for 97,000 units in Karnataka. That is the figure of 17.7. Now it might have slightly gone up. So it is the achievement by the Karnataka.
Very good. I think this is Sagar, you have at the end of the program, you have given a very good news, in fact. Otherwise, we were thinking of only problems. At least you have positive information also. So thank you very much. In fact, it brings smiles on the face of all of us. So I think there is something working somewhere, you see. There are people who are good and working, in fact, for the benefit of the MSME sector. So we have to train others also, I think.
Whoever write to Kasia, ensure that we approach the concerned bank and talk to them and ensure that our member get benefited.
I think
we have been doing it and we continue to do it.
All credit goes to Kasia team. I think Mr. Jagdish and you, Mr. Sagar, are both part of very prominent members. And let me tell you, I have been associated with Kasia for the last almost 15 years since I took over as chairman in 2005. I have been interacting with Kasia teams. A number of times I visited Kasia, and then we had all joint sessions. Even now, in fact, last 6 months also, I think I was in Kasia office. And we are taking up Kasia. Kasia is considered to be a very prominent organization, even in the ministry, everywhere. So we will continue to have interaction with you, Mr. Jagdish and Mr. Sagar. Thank you very much, both of you. I think you have given excellent suggestions. And our MSME sector has got a lot of benefit because of this. Mr. Pugal, thank you very much from Delhi. Delhi is a wonderful product. Millions of people are taking advantage. And hopefully, Delhi and Power to SME both will continue to work together for the benefit of MSMEs in the country. So, we have covered, I think, major issues today. And some of the suggestions that I have noted down, we will surely take it up with the government at the appropriate level. It's a gradual improvement which keeps happening. You see, we have to bring it to the notice of the government at the appropriate level. The government is responsive. The government wants to make changes. The only thing is percolation of these changes and intentions at the down level takes time. It takes months together because the process of transmission is very slow. I was told that even some of the banks have still not received guidelines from their banks about emergency credit line. Some time back, of course. Now, of course, everybody has received and they are working. So, thank you very much. I thank all the participants, in fact, for their participation. thankful to Ms. Sudha Sareen, who is the Senior Vice President of Power to SME and helps in organizes these events. And thank you, Zumair, for your backroom work and networking with various stakeholders to put this program together. So over to you, Zumair.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar. Thank you, sir, for conducting such a insightful, detailed discussion. And before we end the session here, I request all the participants to subscribe to our daily newsletter, SME Khabar. The subscription link is available on the chat. And also do submit your feedback about the webinar, and it will help us in serving you, understanding your concerns better and serving them in our future endeavors in a better way. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Bye.